Well, I'll go ahead and get started. So I'll introduce each of you just prior to your time. So I'll come up if you need to. Well, as everyone is trickling back in after lunch, I hope you enjoyed the morning sessions, and we have great sessions here this afternoon. I am David King. I'm an assistant professor of urban planning here at GSAPP. And this next session, we have three wonderful scholars, and we're going to be talking about travel surveys to crowdsourcing using new forms of data in transportation planning. This is a session that is going to look at how GPS data informs both how we plan for cities, how transportation planning is conventionally done, and some of the new challenges that that are ahead. The authors will be presenting some provocative research that they have. And our first presenter is Michael Batty. Michael Batty is a Bartlett Professor of Planning at University College London, where he is chair of the Center for Advanced Spatial Analysis. Previously, he was director of the NSF National Center for Geographic Information and Analysis in the State University of New York at Buffalo. From 1979 to 1990, he was professor of city and regional planning in the University of Cardiff. His most recent books are Cities and Complexity, which I highly recommend, and Virtual Geographic Environments. His current work focuses on new methods of social physics and involving scaling applied to city systems, and his center CASA is involved in many urban modeling projects informed by new methods of visualization and new online data sources. He is editor of the Journal of Environment and Planning B, Planning and Design. So with that, I will turn it over to Michael Batty.
Okay, well, you'll probably be pleased to hear that I'm not going to talk about scaling and social physics. I'm going to talk about something which is much more sort of direct and practical in some senses, although I'll be talking about some of the research we do in our center. Now, if you look at this title, were I to have given a talk anywhere near like this, maybe 20 years ago, I would probably be using what we called in Britain overhead projectors, overhead slides, or what you call view graphs in a sense. And one of the key features would be that everything on the slide would pertain to location. It would not pertain to movement, but if you look at all the bits and pieces that I've added here, m.batty@ucl.ac is how you can get to me. I was introduced earlier this year to Twitter. I've not been introduced to Facebook yet, but I'm a bit scared of that. I probably need to take Rachel's sort of Facebook for seniors, really, the sort of course. But there's the web address and so on. Of course, the web came on stream with Tim Berners-Lee in 1991-2, so to speak. So prior to that, really, much of this, apart from perhaps the email address, was simply not there 20 years ago. And in some sense, this really is contained in the nature of the title, that no longer are we beginning to think of cities as locations, as places, but we're thinking them really as flow systems. And indeed, today, we've been really talking about flow systems all morning in this sense. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk really about the kind of data coming pertaining to these flow systems, how we can think about modeling it in different ways. And I want to actually really identify different scales and to look at the area-wide scale, but bring it down ultimately to the local street scale with three examples. And I also want to make the point that I think we're in an era now where we confuse strategic with tactical or short-term with long-term in some sense. Many of these data sets that are coming on stream for sort of short-term routine activities can be thought of in terms of long-term. In terms of my first example, I have a kind of long-term strategic land use transportation model that we're using in some sense to look at very short-term issues. Okay, so I'll sort of say one or two more words about what I've just said in terms of one and two, and then give you three examples. I want to start off with a land use transportation modeling problem for Greater London as part of a longer-term climate change assessment, but then look at how we can fragment the networks and locations and see what the impacts are in a very short term. And I'll preface that with some examples about the kind of things that happen in London with respect to how networks get fragmented. And then I want to move to public transport rail systems, say something about our online data that we've acquired from Transport for London. That's the Oyster card data. We have a very big data set, a billion records over 2 months, basically, of all the swipe in and swipe outs on the Oyster card, by the way, is the smart card that is used in London. And we think about 85% of travelers using the tube, overground rail, that's different from intercity rail, and bus are actually using that card because there's a massive price differential if you use it. And the third thing I want to talk about is the public bike scheme. We've already, Janette this morning talked a little bit about that, and I want to say something about local routing and then just finish with a slide saying other things. Okay, obviously a lot of people are talking about cities as places that connect people. Ed Glaser in his recent book, Jane Jacobs here sort of 50 years ago was talking about it in a great book. So the network flow paradigm is really everywhere. And it also relates to the fact that global and local are coming together in unanticipated ways. And all of this stuff is entangled in difficult ways and different ways, etc. And in fact, these are the sort of challenges, theoretically, I think we need to grips with. So some of the models I'll allude to are really set against that background. The other feature is that a lot of the data that we have on short-term dynamics can also inform fast dynamics can also inform slow dynamics. By slow dynamics, I mean changes in population over time. Fast dynamics, of course, is movements such as we saw this morning in terms of buses and cars and so on, in terms of that sort of transportation. Okay, so my three examples will be at the metropolitan regional scale, the local line segment scale, where we're looking at streets, etc., and segments on rail systems, etc., and the finest thing right at the street scale. So the three examples would be scaling down, in a sense, and each of the models that we're using to interpret these data are really rather different in some sense. Okay, I wanted to preface this by looking at some of the kind of things that go on in Britain, etc., to give you a sense of how significant it is to look at how networks fracture. One of the things that's happened in the last 5 or 10 years is that somehow we've been alerted to the fact that our railway systems don't work when the actual leaves drop on the line. Now, in the early 1950s, when I was a small boy, there were a lot of steam trains in Britain, and we never heard about leaves on the line. Whether this is simply because information is now available, but our trains periodically stop when the wrong leaves on the line fall, etc. And apparently this item from the Sun newspaper, the tabloid, tells us that British Rail or whoever have got a way of dealing with it. High speed washing of lines, basically, if you get underneath of that. And then, of course, we've got problems of rails freezing, etc. The Sun, for example, there again, snow joke as winter grips the UK. You can actually see a street there with about half an inch of snow that has stopped the traffic. So there's a whole variety of things that actually clog up the transport system. And in some senses, what we're looking at is how we get a handle on this through new sorts of data. The other feature that's taxing us at the moment, and this pertains to my second example in a minute, that we've been alerted to the fact in London that a third of us are going to have to stay off work during the Olympic Games, otherwise the transport system will clog. There's something from the Washington Post that says that basically it'll be about, you can probably remember Atlanta, the Atlanta debacle. I can't really remember what the transport was there, but obviously it was problematic. So in other words, that our Oyster card data, our tube and public transport modelling and data, in a sense, potentially might inform us about what we might do at certain hubs with respect to that. And then, of course, there's the perennial British disease, basically, the strike, etc., and I'll come back to that, because since Mrs. Thatcher and the Tony Blair's government privatised the tube system, it's difficult to imagine privatising the tube system, but Transport for London run the rail network, I think. And then the lines are privatised. And when you get a union strike, it'll close down a line. Now, if we have good modelling of that and good data on it, then we can see what the impact of closing a line is. Closing the central line, for example, due to a strike, as in this particular instance, from Bond Street, in fact, because not everybody goes on strike, so they run a skeleton service. All of this kind of stuff can be thought about in terms of modelling. Okay, very quickly then. Example one is our land use transportation model for Greater London. Now, this model has 633 traffic assignment zones. They're much bigger than your regular traffic assignment zones. The area of the GLA, the Greater London Authority, is 8 million people. We have very detailed networks in this model. It's a residential location model and a retail model and an industrial model coupled together in the conventional land use transport paradigm. It has four modes, heavy rail, light rail and tube, which is mainly tube, bus and road in that context. It has various sectors, etc. And it also has, which is the most interesting part really, detailed flows of money, wages where people work to where they live, and it also has expenditures on goods where they shop. So in some senses, as the model works, not only do people move, but money actually moves within the model. And travel costs are there as well, because people make decisions based on travel costs. So there's quite a strong economic underpinning to the model. And if we close certain zones for various reasons, or if we close certain lines, etc., then we can see how the money diverts. We can find out, for example, how much money is lost. So, for example, snow on the line, or freezing rails, or strikes, etc., we can figure out how much wages are lost, at least in principle, and then we can get a sense of how the local economy gets distorted in that sense. We can close off zones easily enough. And one of the things I will do, I'll just show you a couple of pictures of the model to give you a sense of it, is I'll show you what happens if we close Heathrow off. For example, if you couldn't get into and out of London Airport, the main airport, Heathrow, then we can figure out how much money is lost. Okay, these are the kind of things, the strikes, etc. Let me just move on to that. This is output from the model. I'll spend a minute just talking briefly about this, that this is the congestion charge. This is accessibility. You can think of this as sort of inverse of transport cost, really. This is our congestion charge area, so this is accessibility. This is actually wages and where people actually work, and this is where they live. And what is very interesting, this is Heathrow, which is a very low-wage economy, the actual airport itself. In terms of what goes on in London, of the 4.5 million jobs, about 2 million are in the centre. There's about 100,000 or 150,000 at Heathrow now, Wembley and so on. So it's a reasonably monocentric city in this particular context. And here's some output from the model. It's coupled, it's very visual, it's coupled to Google Maps. And essentially this particular picture shows you the actual flows on one of the modes from Heathrow. So this is the centre and this is Heathrow. Now we can ask questions of this model. From the model we can figure out, and this is 2001 data, the average income and wage, I'm not going to make a distinction between the two, probably best to think of it in wages, is £18,953. The working population is 4.5 million. That basically translates to something like £86 billion a year. Now, billion is used in the American sense. I actually had to look up the word because I was taught in an era when a billion was a million million. In that sense, but it's 1,000 million in that context, 23 million a day, and that doesn't include bankers' bonuses, right, basically, or things like that. In fact, if we put the bankers' bonuses in, then I think Bob Diamond, who comes from this side of the Atlantic, who owns Barclays, is the president of Barclays Bank, basically earns about 2 billion bonus a year or something like that. Forget the numbers in this particular context. What we want to do is, what happens if we close Zone 6? Now, this is a very simple example. It simply says that we can figure out the amount of lost income would be 2 billion over the year. You wouldn't close it for a year. It'd be 6 million a day, or 2.54% of the income or the wages in the London economy, and about 3% of the jobs are affected by that. So clearly the average income in Heathrow, or the average wage in Heathrow, is a good deal less. It's the low-wage economy in this particular context. Now, we could do this for any area and any closure of any of our modal networks or any of our zones in that sense. So that's the kind of thing we can begin to do with new data sources. My second example, let me change scale very quickly, really relates to our Oyster card data. And I've said all of this earlier on. We've got about, I think we've coded about 700 million records so far over about 6 weeks, basically, but we're due to go to 2 months. We have all swipe in and swipe outs. Here's a picture of data. These hubs, for example, this is the overground rail and the tube system. The bus system is a bit of a problem in London because people only swipe in. We're doing some work on trying to construct multimodal trips from it, from this data, but because people don't swipe out on the bus system, we don't have that data. So only on the rail system do they swipe in and swipe out. That's tube and overground rail. And of course, what we find is that the Monday I looked at, there were 6.2 million people swiped in, and 5.6 million people swiped out. And we made sure that the tube and the buses are all closed in the middle of the night, so we made sure there was no leakage across the day. And this is largely due to the fact that the barriers are often open. A large proportion of travellers using the Oyster card, the smart card, are getting it free. People like me who are over 60 get it free in that context, and there's various other concessions and so on. So to some extent, we've really got to grapple with some of the nature of the data. Fantastic data in terms of flow. I should just say, too, that these represent the typical typical peak hour. This is the day, basically. These represent the individual stations. There are about 600 hubs or stations in this network. The two networks, and the red represents entries, and I think the green represents exits in that sense. And this is actually in at 7 a.m. in the morning, so you can see the sort of the morning peak in that sense. Here's some data that we're doing at the moment with it. We're detrending in a sense, and what we want to try and do is to establish a pattern of sources and sinks in the network. We need to sort of say something sensible about what these different hubs, these different stations are, what purpose they do. So to some extent, this is an intellectual problem, getting to grips with literally what's happening in terms of this complexity. Here's a picture of the size of the tube stations again, and this is the question that we'd like to answer within the next year. When the Olympics is established, the 2, 3, or 4 weeks of the Olympics, etc., what are going to be the critical key stations? We already know that London Bridge is the biggest hub in central London. That has about 600,000 travellers in per day, and that looks to be a real bottleneck in the network. So this, again, is the kind of thing we hope to be able to do with the Oyster card by building some new models. Now, the last example is the so-called Boris bike scheme, after the Mayor of London, Boris Johnson, who introduced the scheme about 15 months or so ago, July 2010. There's about 5,000 bikes and more than twice the number of docking spaces. And one of the things we've got in this data set is that we have a complete record of the use of every bike from the very beginning of the scheme, when it's been taken out, where it's been sort of driven, where it's been ridden to in this particular context. As Janet said this morning, your commissioner said this morning, or somebody said this morning, only about 10 bikes of the 5,000 have actually been stolen or vandalised in that sense. Here's a picture of the bike scheme, and we have a guy in our group called Ollie O'Brien who is measuring this stuff all the time, and the red represent, the blue I think represent empty and the red full, and these are the docking stations. It's all in central London. It's mainly in the congestion charging area. And here he's actually, Ollie in fact, and there's the web address for it, has actually got a whole variety of schemes around the world. In fact, he prides himself on having every scheme that's ever been produced. He has data for it. Unfortunately, the Paris scheme, the Paris authorities told him to take the data offline, basically, because there are certain features of the Paris scheme. It's very big, there's a lot of vandalism, etc., and so on. But the Paris scheme, you'll find, is if you drill down this list from his website. But he has done a mock-up of the New York scheme. I don't know where he got the data from, but I think there is some synthetic data already, in a sense. But you can have a look at that site, and those who are involved in the bike scheme in New York, I think, may recognize this already. Another guy in our group, Martin Auswick, has done some very interesting modeling of the bikes, and there's some videos on Vimeo. One of the interesting features is that basically people use these bikes to go out of mainline stations into the city and the West End, etc., to work. So there's a big shift between the mainline hubs, etc., the big stations where people are coming in on overground and getting either onto underground or onto bikes, basically, to actually move within the centre. So this is a very different kind of transportation problem. It's quite small, in some sense, 5,000 bikes in that context, but it's interesting to kind of define it in terms of sort of transportation behaviour in that sense. Okay, that's my third third example. I just want to say that in our group we're doing other things. For example, John Reeds, who works with Sensible Cities Lab, has done quite a lot with telecoms data, landline data, which is from an unnamed provider, a large unnamed provider in the UK. It can only be one. So this is data that he's done with Francesco Calabrese and Carlo Ratti and the Italians there at Sensible Cities. Johan Serres has done some very interesting timetabling. So if you go to Vimeo and look at that, then he has some very interesting maps he's constructed from timetabling. And those are our blogs, basically, so these will probably be all online, which give you this sort of stuff. And there's my acknowledgements to John, Ollie, Joanne Serres, Duncan Smith, and so on, and the various people who have helped us with this. And then I just want to do one plug at the end. The London Transport Museum have until March next year an exhibition called Sense and the City, and we have a few exhibits in this, but there are many, many exhibits about movement in the city. So if you're in London and in Covent Garden area, go into the London Transport Museum and see that until March next year. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Will. Our next speaker is David Levinson. Dr. Levinson is an associate professor in the Department of Civil Engineering at the David Levinson is a professor of the Department of Civil University of Minnesota and director of the Networks, Economics, and Urban Systems, which is NeXus Research Group. He holds the Richard Braun CTS Chair in Transportation. Academic year 2006-2007, he was a visiting academic at Imperial College in London. In January 2005, he was awarded the CUTC ARTBA New Faculty Award. He earned his PhD in Transportation Engineering at the University of California at Berkeley in 1998. His dissertation, On Whom the Toll Falls, argues that local decision making about managing and financing roads will most likely lead to direct road pricing to allow the efficient allocation of scarce road resources and thus reduce congestion. He has also conducted research into travel behavior. He received the 1995 Thibault Prize in Regional Science for the paper Location, Relocation, and the Journey to Work from 1989 to 1984. He worked as a transportation planner developing integrated transportation land use models for Montgomery County, Maryland. He then applied those models to multinomial network planning and growth management. Levinson has authored or edited several books. He has a new book coming out this month. And numerous peer-reviewed articles. He is the editor of the Journal of Transportation and Land Use.
Thank you. So, I'm talking about time travel and traffic, and this is work that I've done with a number of colleagues and based on a number of research projects. And what we're talking about In transportation planning, one of the central models in the decision of how people choose routes is what's called Wardrop's first principle, named after the British transport researcher who first developed this. And he said that the journey times on all routes that are actually used is equal and less than those which would be experienced by a single vehicle on any unused route, describes how people choose routes. And this model is embedded in any of the regional forecasting planning models that are used by metropolitan areas around the world. Basically, it combines two factors, that people are lazy, the principle of least effort, okay, that people are going to choose the path of least resistance, and the idea of Nash equilibrium, which says that no player in a game benefits by changing the strategy while the others keep theirs unchanged. So you found the path of least effort subject to everyone else doing the same. It should be noted that that this Wardrop principle was developed in parallel with the Nash equilibrium. And John Nash won the Nobel Prize in Economics. Wardrop probably was not aware of the Nash equilibrium at the time that he developed this idea. And it's a very nice, elegant model. Okay, but it does raise an empirical question. Do people actually use the shortest path? So in August 1st, 2007, the I-35W bridge collapsed in Minneapolis. Everyone's probably seen video footage of that. A new bridge in its place reopened in September of 2008, and we did a significant GPS study of travelers before and after the bridge reopening. So we instrumented about 200 cars with GPS units, and they were instrumented for about 8 to 13 weeks over this period. a few weeks before the bridge reopened and then a number of weeks after, and we wanted to see what they did. There were a lot of reasons for collecting this data. We wanted to see how quickly people would turn back to the new bridge, people who had previously used the bridge, would they go back to using the new bridge, how would this affect their travel behavior, and so on. But it allows us to test the Wardrop equilibrium principle. So we had subjects from around the Minneapolis-St. Paul area. The collection of red dots is where people work. The green dots is where people live. So you can see it's scattered pretty well throughout the area. This is downtown Minneapolis and the University of Minnesota, which are right around where the bridge was. We took this raw GPS data. We spent a lot of time trying to match it to make sure that it matched onto the network. Anybody who's worked with GPS data will know that, in fact, a lot of GPS data doesn't match exactly with the road, and there's a lot of work involved in trying to correct for these things. We made sure that people were in the right link, that the link was going in the right direction, that their travel directions were consistent, and so on. And we get a map of this is just simply the observations that we had of these individuals over a 13-week period. We get a huge amount of coverage over both the freeway system, okay, and you can see the traces of the I-494, 694 beltway. You can see I-35W, I-94, the major roads through the city. But we also get very good coverage on the arterial network, and this is important because while we have really good data on the freeways throughout the Twin Cities area and throughout most metropolitan areas in the U.S., there's very poor data on the arterials. Now, in Manhattan, you have taxi GPS data, but that gives you really good coverage on the city streets. But if you go outside, I think you probably will find that you don't have very good travel time information on those routes. So what we did was we looked at individual routes, the routes that people actually took between their home and their workplace. And based on the pooled data, we could figure out what the shortest travel time path was for each individual between their origin and their destination. And we asked the question, do people actually choose the shortest route? And, well, okay, for non-work trips, almost half the people choose the shortest route, and about 15% of work trips are on the shortest route. Now, some of them are on routes that are pretty close to the shortest path or within a minute of the shortest path. Now, for an average of a 25-minute commute, though, somebody who is 2.5 minutes off the shortest path is 10% longer than the shortest path. This is a non-trivial difference. It's interesting to note that non-commute trips, non-work trips, are more likely to be on the shortest path than work trips. I mean, a couple of reasons for that you might think of, and primary is that non-commute trips are shorter, so they have less opportunity to deviate. But the really interesting bit here is the number of people who are 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes off of the shortest travel time path. So the question was asked, do people use the shortest path? And the answer is no. Okay, so now, why does this matter? Well, we all have regional planning models, and these have forecasts of varying accuracy. We assessed the accuracy of the regional planning models in the Twin Cities region from the 1970s, forecasts that were made in the 60s and 70s and 80s for the 1990s and 2000s. We went and did a retrospective analysis. And ideally, you'd get all of the dots aligning on a 45-degree line, meaning that your forecasts were perfectly accurate. This isn't terribly well aligned. And in fact, there's not only error in the forecast, there's systematic error in the forecast. That is, we overestimated the traffic on low volume routes, and we underestimated the traffic on high volume routes. And on the major freeways, we had a major underestimation error. And there's a lot of reasons for this. The route assignment model might be one of them, but there's also, of course, behavioral misses that took place over this period of time. Models that were developed in the 1970s made assumptions about people's travel behavior in the 1970s that, of course, did not necessarily bear out in the 1990s and 2000s. The average trip length was significantly longer, the number of trips per capita was significantly more, and so on. So there's a number of behavioral differences, but I think the model assumptions are also a cause of error. And so the question is, well, why is this source of error existing? So perhaps it's not, if people are taking the shortest path and we just mismeasured them, that's certainly one possibility. It's possible that people are not, their rationality is based on a different metric than just travel time. Okay, people are considering search and information acquisition costs, and there's day-to-day variability, so it makes it very difficult for people to predict. People have a broader objection function than just travel time. Okay, so as was talked about with transit, waiting for transit is valued at 2 times the amount of time as in-vehicle time. People incorporate that information in transit route choice models. Nobody incorporates that kind of information in automobile route choice models. And then perhaps the most interesting hypothesis is that people misperceive the time on the network. If you ask people how long their trip is and they tell you and you actually measure how long it is, you'll discover that people are liars. So first when I say, well, let's look at the mismeasurement hypothesis. Now we use GPS, and so this was measured with engine on to engine off, and maybe people are measuring door-to-door times. And so that would lead to a systematic bias, but it should not have affected the route choices, because that bias is really only between the place between the parking lot and the door, or the garage and the door. And so that's a relatively small source of error, and it shouldn't have affected people's route choices. And then the question is about holes in the data. Okay, so maybe our GPS coverage was incomplete, and it's of course true that our GPS data is incomplete. On the other hand, our GPS data comes from the subjects themselves, so we do have their routes, and we do have other routes that would be plausible for them. So I don't think mismeasurement's the main problem here. Maybe they consider things beyond travel time. And so we have a lot of reasons to believe that people are not strictly rational the way the models assume. Okay, and information costs and transaction costs and bounded rationality are a set of hypotheses out of economics. There's perception and cognition limits. People don't have really good mental maps of the world that they're driving in. They have limited navigation ability. People are not computers, and so we can't just sort of assume that they can compute the shortest path, even if they had all of this information. And there may be people like to drive, you know, so there's excess travel, and people get some pleasure out of that, and so on. So we can look at a number of questions. Looking at how do people experience time, we did a study, and this was done with some colleagues in psychology, looking at how people value time at ramp meters. And we did this two ways. We did a computer-administered study and a virtual experience study. And so here we had people come in and go and sit in front of a computer, and they're given information about several alternatives, one which has a longer overall travel time but no wait at ramp meters. Ramp meters are traffic lights at the entrance ramps to freeways, and some of which had 2 minute or 4 minute or 6 minute waits. And we asked people what they chose, and we got their answers, and we could come up with some estimates. And we put people in a driving simulator. This is a car on the third floor of the mechanical engineering building at the University of Minnesota. I don't know how it got onto the third floor of the mechanical engineering building. And there's a wraparound simulator, and you get in the car, and it feels like you're driving, and there's vibrations, and you know, you can see oncoming traffic, and if you turn the steering wheel, the picture changes appropriately, and so on. And so we put people into this, and we asked them the same kind of question. Basically gave them exactly the same set of experiments, except in this case, instead of telling them it was 2 minutes of delay, we made them wait 2 minutes at a ramp meter light. So you get into this really cool high-tech car, and then we make you wait. And in summary, we get exactly the opposite weights on the ramp delay versus the freeway delay, with the ramp delay from the two different methods of experimenting. So computer-administered state of preference says that people really dislike ramp delay, and the virtual experience state of preference says people are okay with ramp delay, but they really dislike driving in congestion. And so there's a number of reasons why these two methods may come up with different answers. That they're thinking about the experiments differently. Neither one of them is sort of a perfect replication of what's going on in reality. You'd think the virtual experience state of preference would be closer, but you know, in this case, we're asking people at the end of the trip. Maybe if you ask them at the beginning of the trip, they'd feel differently. And so how do people actually weight these things is still unclear. So, you know, we know that there are different weights, but we don't know what they are, and we don't even know the proper signs for them. Okay, so we do know that all time is not created equally, so saying that you're going to minimize travel time if time isn't the same across different types of travel, stop and go conditions versus free flow conditions versus waiting at a ramp meter, then they're not minimizing travel time. They might be minimizing weighted travel time, but then we don't really know what the weights are. Okay. But this information is important. Currently, MnDOT has, after a lot of public feedback and a major study in 2001 where they turned off all the ramp meters, sets the maximum ramp delay at 4 minutes because they know that, or they believe that, and this is what the computer administrator's state of preference says, is that ramp delay is more onerous than freeway delay. So waiting at a ramp meter is worse than waiting on a freeway. Now, this doesn't apply just to auto travel. We did a similar type of experiment with bicyclers, and they would sit in front of a computer and they'd see two movies, and we'd ask them which condition they would prefer, riding on an off-road trail that took 40 minutes or riding on a bike lane next to traffic that took 20 minutes, and then if they chose the 20 minutes, then we would change the travel times and we would iterate this to get a solution. And we'd give them different kinds of conditions, different movies, and these were all taken from the point of view of a bicyclist. Kevin Kryzik, who worked on this study, basically did some hands-off, you know, basically filmed this while riding a bicycle. It's just a skill that I don't have. And we come up with what the various weights are for different kinds of conditions. And we can see that males and females weight travel time differently, and travel times are weighted differently in the winter versus in the summer. And so we know, again, that the weights are going to be different, okay? But that's, of course, a computer-administered stated preference type of study. Well, maybe if you put people in the field, it would be different. So Francis Harvey and Kevin and I did another study where we gave a bunch of bicyclists GPS units, and we first had them choose their own route, which they go from home to work. These are regular bicyclists. And the second week, we assigned them a different route, and then we asked them to tell us how they like the route. And the third week, we assign them a different route and ask them to tell us how they like the route. And you can see 30F means a 30-year-old female. And these are a bunch of people who lived in South Minneapolis who work typically in downtown or near the University of Minnesota. And you could see differences between the subjects about what the preferred routes were. And sometimes people had similar routes as their preferred route to the shortest path. Some people, of course, had routes that were significantly longer than the shortest path. So it's not just drivers who take routes that are longer than the shortest path. Bicyclists will do the same to get a better quality of condition is the reason we think that's going on. So you take a more complicated route, a longer route, but you can avoid traffic, so your conditions are better. Okay, and people might be willing to go on an off-road trail. They'll even be willing to go farther if they can take advantage of an off-road trail. Okay, so we need to consider the quality of traffic conditions. So we want to do some more experiments. We took a bunch of subjects. We said drive from the University of Minnesota to the Cathedral in St. Paul and back on a set of different routes. Now, this wasn't their normal commute, but this was a controlled experiment on five different routes. We had them drive four of them. They could drive on the freeway, and that would be generally faster, but it's a freeway. They could drive on University Avenue, which is a classic at the time. Now it's under construction because they're putting a light rail in there, but at the time it was a classic strip highway with some big box shopping centers and old factories that have been converted into lofts and condominiums and various other strange land uses, which is generally slower because of traffic signals. Marshall Avenue, which is a residential street and leads to a nice area. Summit, which is a mansion street, and Grand Avenue, which is an old shopping street. And we wanted to see how they weighted the different routes. And the fact is that people don't only consider their travel time, they also consider the adjacent land uses as a factor when they're choosing their routes. And it depends on their familiarity of the route and whether they're given information or not about the route. So he said, okay, can we do a revealed preference study with drivers? Okay, where we put them on a road, the problem with the previous study was, well, they're going between the university and the cathedral and back, that's not really where they're going, so maybe they're not motivated. This doesn't necessarily get us at what the real conditions are. Okay, so we recruited a bunch of subjects in the I-394 corridor. Who lived west of downtown Minneapolis, and there was a hot lane here, and so they could drive on the hot lane, they could drive on the freeway in the untolled lanes, or they could drive on a parallel arterial, and part of the hot lane is separated by paint, and part of it is a barrier-separated facility. We gave them a GPS unit, we gave them a transponder, and we asked them to rate their trips, but the most important thing that we did was we then gave them, after they rode on the routes that we told them to. We had them drive again with an uncontrolled on an uncontrolled route, so they could choose their preferred route. And in fact, their preferred routes changed from before the experiment to after the experiment, so that forcing them to drive on these alternatives changed what they chose to do. So people experiencing different routes may change their opinions of what their preferred routes are. And we can see how the diamond lane operates. And obviously, different people would have different arterial routes as their shortest path, but they were all, 394 was all a plausible route for all of the subjects. And we found out that it wasn't just travel time, but we were also looking to see about travel time reliability, or the variability in travel time was an important factor. And of course, it was an important factor in choosing routes. And then there's the question of travel time perception. Okay, so we put people in front of a computer, and this is a simulation, and we had them wait at a traffic light. And they could wait at traffic lights for different amounts of time, and then they would have some free flow conditions. And we could see that the perception, that the accuracy of their travel time perception depends on their signal weight. So the people would be pretty good at estimating short waits, but they would be problematic at estimating long waits. So there's going to be some systematic perception error of their travel time. And so we can conclude a number of things. Okay, we've done a set of technologically enabled experiments, and we can conclude that our theory that people choose the shortest path is wrong. They do not choose the shortest time path. And there's a number of reasons for this, okay? Because they value travel conditions differently, they value the quality of the route, not just the route itself, but adjacent land uses along the route. Is it pleasant to look at? Is it pleasant to drive? They value the reliability of their route. They value the familiarity and how much experience they have, and a set of other factors. Okay. Now, all of these things are difficult to value, and they depend. You know, the valuation estimates that we get depend on our experimental designs, but we really need to understand that directly. And we can also observe from this study and some others that people systematically misperceive the network. So if we were to change the structure of the network, they would overestimate or underestimate the travel times that they face. And so from that, we can use this new generation of technology, GPS units and so on, to come up with better models for transportation planning and travel forecasting. So that, thank you.
Thank you, David. Our final presenter in this session, and then after he presents, we will bring the panel up for questions. But our final presenter is Mitchell Moss. Mitchell Moss is the director of the Rudin Center for Transportation and Henry Hart Rice Professor of Urban Policy and Planning at New York University's Wagner Graduate School of Public Service. He served as the director of NYU's Taub Urban Research Center from 1987 to 2003. He has directed research projects for the National Science Foundation, U.S. Department of Homeland Security, U.S. Department of Commerce, and leading private corporations. Professor Moss has been on the faculty at NYU since 1973 and served as the chairman of the Interactive Telecommunications Program in the Tisch School of the Arts from 1981 to 1983. Professor Moss's essays have been published in the New York Times, San Francisco Chronicle, New York Post, New York Daily News, Newsday, the New York Observer. From 1983 to 1994, he served as the deputy of the chairman of Governor Cuomo's Council on Fiscal and Economic Priorities. In 2001, he served as an advisor to the mayoral campaign of Michael Bloomberg. In 2009 and 2010, he testified before the U.S. House of Representatives Committee on Transportation and Infrastructure on the role of state and local governments in disaster recovery and rebuilding. Moss received his BA from Northwestern University, his MA from the University of Washington, and his PhD from the University of Southern California. Please welcome Mitchell Moss.
Can I get lights for just a few minutes, Georgia? First of all, let me thank Georgia for organizing this meeting and Professor King for inviting me. And since everybody here has heard these two panels, I want to take the advantage of being third to just speak briefly about some issues regarding the title of the conference, which, as you may remember, was Transportation Data and Technology in Cities. Let me first say three things. You know, I run the Rudin Center, but I have a terrific bunch of people who work with us, and They're back there, and Joshua Mandel and Carson Wing, they're the brains. I'm just the voice. And I want you to know we have a presentation I'll give in a few minutes, but I think there are four trends we should understand about transportation and information technology, which I think are related to some of the conversation we've heard from Professor Batty and Professor Levinson. One I think is important is that the role of information is going to be more important in transportation than transportation. By that I mean in this country, we have built the interstate highway system largely. We're seeing a gradual reduction in public support for new mass transit in this country. And although I think there's a terrific focus on building infrastructure, the capacity to finance it in this country is not yet clear. So what is going to happen is I think we're going to find out that we're going to be living within the systems we have, trying to make them better and more productive, as you heard Janette Sadik-Khan this morning, by using streets more creatively. But I think information is going to be very important. And I always tell people, when I get on the train at Houston and Broadway, which I consider to be the center of the universe, I want to say this is the first time I've been north of 14th Street in a year. But that's because of Professor King. I need a passport. I consider going to Jersey going out of the country. And I never go overseas that far west. Anyway, so the point I want to make is that we're living in a very different environment of transportation from that of the 1990s when we were seeing investment and willingness to, I think, fund large-scale projects. I think the appetite for transportation spending has been reduced because the automobile is so efficient that we get very little out of the gasoline tax anymore. So those of you who understand transportation should know that the gasoline tax is less and less productive because cars are more and more efficient, so you can go further and further with less gas. And so the entire financing of infrastructure, which is based on the fuel tax, is turning out to be a very, very weak instrument for financing. And that's why Professor Levinson's work on tolling and other things is going to be more important, because we're eventually going to have to find another way to finance our infrastructure. So information is going to be more important because all of us are going to have to be more creative in figuring out how to use the limited infrastructure we have. And when I said earlier, when you get on the subway, the first thing you know people do at Houston and Broadway, and I'm sure it's true at 116th and Broadway, is when they get out of the train, as they come up the steps, they turn on their phone. And any of you who get off a plane today know the plane lands, the phones go on. When I'm in Britain, the train, British Rail, is basically a phone system in motion. I've never seen more talkers than on British Rail, and I think Professor Batty would confirm this. It is, you know, if the British Rail had understood the power of the phone, they'd be making much more money, because the phone is really making the train a very productive system. And this is important because I think you should know, and Anthony Townsend, who's speaking later, who's probably the brightest guy in mobile systems in the world, told me last night that in the world itself, you should know that the U.S. and Canada lag the entire world in having internet access on their subway. And he'll, I'm sure, tell you about this recent survey, but in this country, you know, and in Canada, less than half of all the subway systems have internet access. I, of course, know that if you take the trains and you go above ground on the F train in Brooklyn or parts of the IRT in Manhattan, you can get internet service, phone service. But what I think is important is that information is becoming central to transportation in several ways, and let me just explain them. First, contrary to everybody's belief, it's made automobile driving very productive, because congestion isn't congestion anymore. It's just a chance to be on the phone. There are physicians who basically use the entire route they have at home on the way home to deal with patients and returning calls. The car used to be downtime. Now it's a productive part of many people's day because they're able to be engaged in some aspect of work. And so, you know, I think the reason we are able to tolerate longer drives in many cases to work is because you're not in traffic, you're on the phone. And I think there's a great misunderstanding of congestion. Congestion for many people is a chance to text. You know, they love the red lights. That's when they can really use their BlackBerries. And I have a daughter, and she has one hand on the wheel, one hand on the iPhone. I never know where we're going, but you know, most young people are driving with one hand only now, and I think everyone knows that, and they really have been able to hide that phone from the police. And so I think we should understand that the phone is now an adjunct to the steering wheel for many people, and for people taking mass transit, you know, it's one of the great ironies that you can use it on the Accela, you can use it on commuter trains, you can't use it in New York's subway system. We're very proud that we've come of age. We have six subway stations which give you telephone service in New York City out of over 500 stations. It's a long way to go. So what I want to point out is that the phone is now crucial for many people who are moving, and you see, you're going to see this on the planes increasingly, as part of the way in which being out of accessibility is no longer true. In many planes, especially those of you who I know who take Virgin America is the most sophisticated airline in this country for Wi-Fi access, and I think we should know that traveling by plane used to be you're out of contact, and the most important part when you got off the plane was you went to the payphone to tell someone something, and you can still see the payphones at many airports. The truth is, flying is no longer going to be something where you're out of contact. I think we're seeing this in driving. We don't see this in mass transit in this country, certainly not in this region. Second point I want to make is that the journey to work, which has been the dominant model for transportation models, was based on people going to work 5 days a week, different hours, but basically 8 to 4, 7 to 3, 9 to 5. The journey to work has now been disrupted by telecommunications. This is amazing. The MTA will not tell you, but I will tell you, the peak day for commuting is Wednesday. There's been a lag. Monday and Friday, people are not commuting. And the higher you go on the food chain of work, the more flexibility you have. The highest point of those who are professors who don't work at all, or they certainly don't, or they will tell you they're working all the time. But the point is that, as Michael Batty said, cities aren't places, they're flows. Well, that's what academic life has been saying for many years about a professor. It's not where you are, it's what you're doing. Well, what's happened is that spread to the rest of the, I would say, the high-end service professional. And what is important here is that there is more flexibility about how you organize your time. And this is not about telecommuting in a large organization. This is about the ability for people to actually be regularly working from terminals, from Blackberries, from iPhones, and not being in an office. And that has changed the journey to work. And in this region, we no longer think of people at a 9-to-5 basis. The subway system is now so busy that it used to be 6 or 7 o'clock, it tailed off. It's now looking like the San Diego freeway. It never stops. And those of you who ride the train, particularly I'm sure at night and midnight, it is now fully packed with people. And I think this is important to understand that the work day is no longer defined by daylight hours. You know, we have this agricultural model, but it's not the way work is done anymore. You know, the rock musicians were the first to discover this. They woke up at 4 in the afternoon, and then they really didn't perform till midnight, and then they got loaded, and who knows whatever was going on. And I think it's now become a general pattern of our, you know, workforce that it is no longer defined by rigid hours, and that means the transit system has much more stress. I just want to say one thing. There's only one major city in the whole world with a 24-hour subway system, and you're in it. It's New York. Everywhere else, they close down for some number of hours. In Boston, they close down an hour before the bars. In London, I think they close it. I mean, figure that one out. But in, you know, I think in London, they're very proud they close down for new repairs. In New York, they're finding out it's harder and harder to do maintenance, which is why they moved it all to the weekend, because the subways are busy well into the 1 or 2 o'clock hours. And the reason this is important is to understand that the nature of work today is not defined by normal hours. Telecommunications has allowed you to be globally connected. And so some people go get to work early in the morning so they can deal with, you know, markets in Europe. Other people are working very late for other reasons. But I think communications has changed the journey to work. And that's an important theme because it has created a stress on mass transit systems, especially because many of the ones that can work 24 hours makes a great advantage for New York. We're a much more productive place because people can come and go at all hours. Third point I want to make, and this is something which I think we sometimes forget, you know, is that, and Andrew Munshine, who's with the Rudin Center, who's brilliant on this point, has pointed out that the ability to get information in your hand by an iPhone or Android has made people much more willing to be explorers in how far they go. In other words, people are willing to walk because they have a map in their hand. I had a niece who came to New York. I won't say where she was from, but she was so afraid of the subway, she walked from the Village to Columbia every day because she didn't understand how to, the steps, the understand. You know, the subway is not normal for most Americans. And what's interesting is that people are now opening up. They get out of the subway, look at their iPhone, they figure out where to go. And what's important is that the same is true with driving. You're willing to go many places because you're not, you know, listening to someone's instructions. You don't have to rely on an AA map.
And so distance has become something that people are more secure with because they have an electronic map in front of them or a GPS system. And so in a kind of amazing way, pedestrian activity and driving are all affected by having handheld mobile devices. And I think this is going to be a very important part of, you know, understanding how New York works. People who want to go to the meat market, which is the 14th Street Gainesville Market, you know, might not have gone there, but now they have an iPhone. They figure out how to get there. The streets aren't normally configured. It allows cities to be penetrable in places where we don't have mass transit. It allows cities to be penetrable where they don't have bus service. And of course, you know, I think this is one of the great benefits of handheld devices, that it's given people more autonomy. Because in New York, if you relied on our street signs, you'd be completely lost. And I just want everyone here to think about the idea of what it means. How does a person coming from Europe find a subway station if they don't know that it's a green lit bulb? Because there's not even wording on those. In other words, we don't tell people how to find the metro station as they do, you know, in Paris. We have no signals on the street level to tell you where to go down. And I think it's important to understand it's the mobile devices that have made it possible for tourists to maneuver through the city of New York. So I think telecommunications is a vital factor in changing the experience of travel, whether it's in the air, on your feet, in a car, in mass transit. And I wanted to make sure that I convey that now, because I think it's going to become more important, not less, as we build or cut back on our infrastructure building, for at least for the short term. So let me quickly go to our presentation, if I could. Is this okay?
Yeah.
We don't have any of those kind of sexy graphics that Professor Batty brought, you know, any of those kind of high-end, you know, I wish I had done that, because we have some nice, because I love showing somehow our traffic doesn't work sometimes. But, well.
Left and right.
Okay. So this is what we were trying to do. And I'll try to walk through this. We have a report which has the methods, and you'll be able to see the fabulous work done by Carson and Joshua here. But basically, we're looking at the way mobile communications are going to be important in major metropolitan regions of the United States. And we look at the way in which, you know, data accessibility, the network strengths in regions, and the actual users are going to interact to affect the way in which people can use information technology. Now, let me just say something to you. Everyone here, looking at the age, you know, we now know through the Pew Research Foundation that, you know, the younger you are, the more likely you have a smartphone. Remember, smartphone penetration is inversely related to age. The older you are, the less likely you have one. It's much more common people under 30. And what you should know, and I'm sure you do know, that there's enormous evidence that mobile traffic is growing. I think Anthony Towns is going to give a great talk tonight about this amazing demands on our networks. But what I think I want to highlight here is that the importance of really understanding that the maps are one of the most important parts of the mobile device experience. In fact, 60 million Americans, we point out, access maps from their mobile devices, and it's one of the top four uses of all handheld smartphones. Let me now point out something else that, you know, as I said earlier, we're seeing a very, very important shift in which public investment infrastructure, especially the large fixed infrastructure, is not growing. And therefore, everyone is going to have to figure out a way to make do with this existing system. And that means those people are going to be living by all the ways in which they can maneuver, whether it's taking different roads, as you heard from Professor Levinson, or whether it's kind of figuring out different routes or different modes. So our theory is that information is going to be more important to you, the user. I don't think we can count on innovation coming from large transit agencies as much as we're seeing it from the widespread dispersed network of people who develop apps, and those are, you know, constantly changing and growing. So what cities and what regions will be in the best position? And here we kind of looked at a mix of factors, and I think it's important that it's not just having an app, it's not just having a smartphone. We looked at three key factors. One, having open data. And, you know, really this is important. Public agencies, which often are in charge of mass transit, have to release the information they have so that developers and user communities can find ways to make this information accessible to you, the user. And of course, they vary substantially, and we're going to show how, you know, even though you might have a big agency do it, it's not just having one agency. You have to have everyone provide information, and hopefully eventually real-time information. The second part, of course, is, you know, the network strength. You know, this is something we really should be much more aware of, which is that, you know, having connectivity is the key ingredient, or else you're, you know, this room doesn't have it, so we have no cell phones going off. But, you know, the key part is that we have to have, you know, phenomenal capacity within a region, and they vary tremendously in this country. You know, I tell people in New York City, I don't like to work in a building where I don't have phone access in the elevator. Since we just heard earlier about the waiting time and congestion, in New York, it's the waiting for the elevator. And, you know, a building with, I think anyone who builds a modern building without having access, we need phone-to-phone access from the lobby to the office, and elevators tend not to have it. And eventually people aren't going to work in those kind of settings. Well, network strength, in this case, means the entire region, and there is great variation. That means in terms of download speed and penetration, the kind of towers that are available, et cetera. I need not tell you there are parts of Midtown Manhattan where we still have dead zones. You know, it's kind of amazing. And people tell me, oh, the Brooklyn Bridge is one of the most famous, but there are others. And finally, the real question, of course, is, you know, what kinds of people live in a region? Who you are they smartphone users? Are they developers? Is there a cluster of people who are willing to kind of make the effort to develop new apps for those people? Oh, that's great. Now, okay, so here is our what we did, and I just wanted to give you a quick look. What kinds of data were we talking about? Well, there's the open data, obviously some of you know, the Google Transit feed. Then there's real-time applications. You know, different kinds of information can be available. And, you know, we've learned, if we've studied this, that you have to have enormous amount of agreement in a region for all this data to be available to people. The second part is looking at the accessibility. You know, we looked at it being available on buses, on subways, on rail, commuter rail. And we have had a method, and you'll read in the paper, the different ways we assign this to the different modes. Now, what did we come out in terms of data accessibility? This is, of course, the part that is the most interesting. We ranked them. Carson and Josh did a great job here. And, of course, Boston and Cambridge has phenomenal, I think, data accessibility. In part, that's because, you know, the MBTA has fabulously made available all their data in an open system, and they have coordinated with the rest of the region. Poughkeepsie and Newburgh, whoever would have thought anything good could be said about Poughkeepsie. Well, we found something. That's because the commuter rail makes it very available. People depend on commuter rail there. And then we went Portland, Washington, you'll see. And these are the areas where data is available. And we talked about having real-time data available. And New York isn't here. And I'm going to point out the reason is very simple. We have an enormous number of commuter bus systems which don't make this data available. We have a lot of people who ride on a variety of transit systems which this has not yet happened. And so we're not yet in that area. Even if the MTA did it, there are many, many other commuter systems coming into this region. And here you see, shows you where the you have many providers, like New York and LA, that kind of hurts us. But you have others, many providers on the right, you have Washington, Sacramento, those are the places that lead. And of course, the laggers are down below. And this, I think, will all, through George's great work, be available by tomorrow morning, I'm sure. Now, because I assume. Now, let me just talk about network strength, and I'll just go this quickly. You know, we should not assume that because it's an advanced metropolitan region, you have great strength universally available. So we looked at the broadband coverage across the region. This is through an FCC report. We looked at Wi-Fi coverage, then the median mobile, the broadband speed download, and of course, Wi-Fi and availability underground systems. That's a dream for those of us who live here, and this was the waiting. And let me just show you what we came out with. And of course, this is interesting in its own right, because here we found, and you find, what I found was great about this is that different regions lead according to different criteria. There's no dominant leader. And here it was obviously the San Jose, Sunnyvale, the kind of, I would say, the peninsula below San Francisco. Then you had the Philadelphia region, Milwaukee. Once again, we're always surprised. You know, whenever it's something good in the Midwest, I'm happy for them. I think the rest, you can see this. We weighted them, and you can see that there really is a case where New York is number nine here. It's not at the top, despite the fact that we have great broadband kind of capacity in some parts of the city. Now, let's just quickly go to the demographics. This, everyone here, I'm sure, is aware of this phenomenal kind of way in which you can look at smartphone penetration and know it's tied to income. People over making over 75,000 have very high levels of penetration there. It's tied to education. It's inversely tied to age, as I pointed out. And in fact, low-income households, minority households, use their smartphones for internet access. One of the great things people don't appreciate is that if you're African-American or Latino, you're going to have less access in your home or your office to high-speed computer capability and to the internet. The smartphone is the way in which you access the internet. So that is their internet access. It's a mobile system. And here's how we did this and the weighting we gave. And let me just show you the rankings, which I think will be interesting. And here again, once again, here you can tell San Jose and Sunnyvale, you know, the peninsula below San Francisco is leading here in terms of this. And of course, it makes sense given the kind of workforce they have and given the industries that are based there. Washington, D.C., San Francisco, Oakland. And of course, you know, you see this is largely West Coast oriented. Yes, we have one minute. This is great. We're going to do this in about 30 seconds then. And then let me just show you, this was our composite ratings. We tried to tie it all together. I think it's most important to understand how different regions have different strength, comparative advantages, that it isn't one, but these are the top as we rank them. And here are our key findings. San Francisco, San Jose, the user and industry demographics really give them a kind of advantage. Washington, D.C. is number two, then San Diego for composite. And Boston, of course, as well. And this is tied to their industry as much as to the kind of workforce that they have there. And what we really have is pointing out that, you know, you have to have a multi-sector approach if you want to be able to use telecommunications and transit. It's got to be based on the network, it's got to be based on data, and it's got to be based on making sure the users and the app developers are there. And here in New York, you can see, although it is very strong in some areas in terms of big public transit, we do have many, many providers of transit who are not making the data available. And the same thing occurs in Los Angeles. Chicago is much more consolidated. I don't want to take any more of your time because I want to have room for discussion. And you should know everything I think will be available, both the PowerPoint and the paper, online by tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Well, I'd like to invite the panel to come up to the front while somebody gets the lights on. Certainly, I think we heard three presentations that are very provocative in how new types of data really affect the transportation planning process and the transportation planning, the conventional way we go about transportation planning. So with that, I would like to open up the floor to questions right off the bat. I see here, well, we'll go with Shinpei and then Charlie after that. We're getting the microphone, so you go ahead and speak now.
To help direct or guide project prioritization for future infrastructure investments.
I think it's an interesting question about whether public data can be used for infrastructure investments, and part of the problem is that we've been developing long-term plans with very long horizons. So in the Twin Cities area with which I'm familiar, we have a highway plan that was designed in the 1960s, which has lines on the map that aren't quite finished, but the first priority for the lines on the map that they're going to build are the lines that were drawn in the 1960s, not based, at least for new links, rather than where real-time conditions suggest that the problems are today. And One of the issues is that while we can get flows and find out where today's problems are in the existing system, we don't really have information about where demands are for links that haven't been built. You know, we don't have a good way from the existing data set to know where potential solutions that aren't already on the network can be implemented. So while data is important, it can't be used in the absence of models. And so finding a balance of taking advantage of this data to bring forward more appropriate investment strategies with a good set of models that tell us alternative solutions beyond just expanding the scope of existing facilities. Well, run more buses down this corridor or widen this roadway or put more bikes here. You can do that if you say, well, the demand is really high here, but you can't know where the demand is for a facility that hasn't been built. So we need to be able to combine both of these two things in a useful way.
Charles, coming off a comment and a question for Professor Moss. Fascinating presentation. I learned a great deal. But on the diminution of the Highway Trust Fund, you know, due to fuel efficiency, I think we should all be mindful of the fact that it's been 18 years now since the gasoline tax was raised in nominal terms, and that the erosion of that gas tax due to inflation has actually had a greater effect in reducing the amount of financial resources than has the simultaneous improvement in fuel economy. But the question has to do with the use of all this terrific mobile communications technology by drivers. And I'm kind of two minds. On the one hand, it's terrific and very exciting, and the other, as somebody who cycles, and cycling is obviously something, even though it wasn't mentioned in your talk, something that is beginning to become more and more part of the urban transportation fabric. I was sort of feeling it as your discussion as kind of a death sentence for me and other people who are on the road trying to share that space or being forced to share that space with drivers. So I was wondering if you have any solution to that conundrum.
Well, first, I don't believe in a death sentence, even for bicycles. But I would say, we have a very primitive system for allocating public streets right now. Let me say something. The streets are highly contested in New York City. That is a great thing because it means everybody wants to be out and using them, and they're going places. And now we're seeing they're being contested. We've got the horses, we have the bicycles, we have the pedestrians, we have the drivers, we have a lot of people, we've got the Fresh Direct. And what's I think important is that, I don't think we've really done very well in putting technology into the streets. In other words, we have 29,000 free parking spaces on the island of Manhattan. I'm not sure that most of the parking laws are industrial era, meaning that it's 8 to 6, no parking Monday to Friday. It's as if the city suddenly was vacant on the weekends and therefore so I'm not sure that it's just a matter of bicycling. I mean, we haven't really figured out a way to accommodate what is basically a different way of moving, which is that, we're going to have many more people walking. The sidewalks are much too narrow in many places. And I think your point about the bike paths is, of course, this was a very quick fix because we didn't really, we could have expanded the sidewalks and then had bike lanes and got rid of some of the parking. But let me just say one thing about your question. What we're doing now is we basically are using the parking of cars as a way to protect the bicyclists, which I'm not sure it's a good solution. The quick fix, I'm not sure it works. In other words, you put a car next to, that's the barrier to protect the bicyclists. And of course, the real professional cyclists don't like the bike lanes because they're too slow, as we just heard earlier about, sometimes they'd rather not be in the lanes. I don't think we yet have solved this problem. I don't think you should think of it as a death sentence. What I think you should know is that I think that, cycling has become the mode of choice for much of the internet economy. As they leave Fort Greene, they want to bike to the west side of Manhattan. And anyone who doesn't understand that, a bike-friendly city is important for the economy. It's not a matter of, I'm not talking about, I want to take a bike ride for the afternoon. The bike-friendly mode to work has actually become part of the changing occupational structure of the city. That's why it's important. It's not because people are racing. It's because biking is actually the preferred choice for many of the people who work in some of the newer parts of the economy. That's why we should have it. We should not treat it as kind of as if it's a leisure choice. It's a mode for some part of the economy to get to work, and you want to make sure that sector has a choice. I actually think it's important because just as ferries are important, as we build less mass transit, biking, ferries, all these other flexible systems, even Professor King's work on taxis, I think, would show this. There are lots of other modes people need because that's going to be important, especially as we have settlement in parts of New York City where there is no mass transit. Remember, 1/4 of all of New York City is not within a 1/2 mile of mass transit, and the island of Manhattan, where the newest development is, has no mass transit, which is really, on the far, far west side. So biking is not going to shrink. It's going to become important because that's how you get to some of these places.
I'm here in urban planning. And my question is really based, I think, on the provocation that Professor Moss put out to us, which is that this kind of question about transportation and data and so on is highly linked to a particular climate in the US, which is on the one hand limits on public finance and supports, political supports for a certain kind of infrastructure spending, and on the other hand, sort of a boom of information technology that is clearly making it more likely that certain old styles of transportation use might actually be more tenable than one thought. So if I think about sort of the context of some of the very interesting work put up, how would the three scholars here at the panel discuss what is going on, say, in a China or in an India or a Kenya, where on the one hand, huge amounts of infrastructure spending on transportation and a boom in ICT, but the baseline or quality of physical infrastructure is actually much, much worse in terms of the city itself. So I'd like to put some of your work into the context for what we can learn in some other places. Thank you.
Let me try and respond to that. Yeah, it's somewhat ironic that when I first went to China in 1986, I was in Guangzhou and at Zhongshan University, and the TV was just about seeable. It was black and white, very fuzzy. And one of the big bridges in Guangzhou, each time they showed the news, they showed this great horde of people coming across. It took me a long while to realize they were all bicycles, right? Went back there last year, no bikes. And it's somewhat ironic that in China the massive growth of car ownership and the demise, really, of cycling, I mean, that's the way I see it. I may be somewhat ill-informed in this sense, is quite the contrast to what is happening, for example, in cities in the developed countries, in some sense, large cities in the developed countries. And the difficulties, I think, really relate often to space. One of the reasons, the amount of space available. So one of the reasons, for example, in Britain and certainly the Netherlands, which are relatively high density economies or cities in terms of population densities, that is that there really is very little space available to some extent. That were there more space available, then I suspect we might see rather different transportation alternatives. So I think that has to be sort of factored in. And then I think there's this question of regulation that doesn't quite address your problem, but different transportation systems need different styles of regulation, which clearly are cultural. So for example, in the British context, I mean, this addresses perhaps the previous question rather than yours, the growth of cycling, for example, in a city like London, is leading to all kinds of problems. First of all, it's extremely dangerous. The accident rate is very high among cyclists. We need new regulations in terms of bikes need to have lights on at night, for example, and people need to wear crash helmets. None of this legislation mm-hmm. is in place in the UK. It is for motorbikes in that sense. But and then, of course, there's the actual the space question, the configuration of our cities. That the biggest conflict that's emerged is actually between pedestrians and bike and cyclists at the present time. That quite a lot of accidents relate to pedestrians being knocked down by bikes. So I think there's a lot of issues related to the really rather basic things in terms of the conflict between these different modes. So I guess the critical issue is in terms of the conflict between many different modes of transport and getting that right in some sense in terms of regulation and also pricing in a sense. That doesn't quite address the issue you related about developing countries in that sense, but I'm sure that in some senses those issues of conflict between modes really, which are slightly different there, need to be resolved equally well.
Can I just say that I think Professor Batty made a comment about the automobile growth in China. In the developing world, traffic fatalities kill more people than HIV. That's the leading cause of death. That's the public health problem, not HIV. Traffic deaths, totally unregulated from every way, the road, the driver, the car, and you know, if that is going to become even more so because car growth in those areas is exponential.
Yes, we have a microphone coming down.
I'm Nicole Volofka. I'm from Columbia University, and sorry, this again goes to Professor Moss, but I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about the quality of life and things like mental health and actually impacts on productivity if you have people with the opportunity for to be on their cell phones when you are underground with people on long trips or on the bus. And I think many of us can imagine, you know, just those long crosstown bus trips when there are two people yapping and I can't be productive because I can't read and I can't think about anything. And it goes for elevators too. I can't think of anything worse than being stuck in an elevator with 10 people on their phones. So, how is this figured in? And I mean, frankly, it would discourage me from using mass transit, which I think that everybody should be trying to promote. So what kind of surveys are being done to, you know, to get information about this? And how, if any way, is this information factored into what you're promoting?
Well, first, let me say, I'm not confident to talk about mental health. I really feel that, you know, I'm sure everybody has their own experiences and it's not an area, but I think what you did refer to is I think that the way in which the phone is altering the experience of transportation, that the collective subway experience used to be people reading the newspaper. Now they're hand on, you know, they're looking at their iPhone or iPad or BlackBerry or a game, and now of course your point about the elevator. You know, whenever I see people on the phone and the elevator, I try to mimic a phone call just to disrupt theirs. You know. That may be viewed as kind of hostile behavior, but I certainly agree with you. But I think what you're going to see is this is why Amtrak has had quiet cars. I mean, the conflict, I think, which you're pointing out to, is we've become accustomed to some zones where you were out of contact, and once you're always in contact. And I think the British have had some of this experience with British Rail, right?
The great joke is, of course, that probably about 15 years ago when mobile phones, we call them mobiles, you call them cell, when mobiles became sort of significant, British Rail basically said that one coach was to be reserved in each train for the mobile phone. Over a 15-year period, that's changed to one coach to be reserved for not using the mobile phone, for the quiet thing. So it's completely shifted in that sense due to exactly what you said, that, as you said, it's a walking sort of mobile phone sort of journey in that sense. I think this question of the quiet space is extremely important and has to be thought through properly. The other joke that's circulating around Britain at the moment is that the Chinese, the British, London Transport for London, who run the tube, basically put out some feelings for whether or not we should have mobile phones in the tube. The tube is very deep in London, and so it's difficult to do. And of course, the Chinese were very interested in doing this. Now there are some security issues about putting phones in the tube, meaning having a big Chinese company doing it. But the joke at the moment is that we will let them put mobile phones and phone coverage into our tube as long as the Chinese bail out Greece. So they're off the sun.
So there's two aspects of this which are temporary. One is the continued use of voice commute. I mean, if people are just simply texting on a piece of glass, well, it might be moderately disruptive, but it's certainly not as disruptive as people talking. And we've always had people talking next to each other. I mean, I sit on an airplane, I'm annoyed by the other people who are talking when I'm trying to read, but hopefully there's enough white noise around that you don't hear it too much. But the second is there are some interesting technologies coming out which sound far out, but David blogged about it recently, the mind control. That is, we can, if we wire up people's foreheads or their throats, they can control communication information flows without actually having to speak. So we don't have to have a voice control device, we just need to have something that's wired to your body. And so you can effectively talk without opening your mouth. It would be conveyed to the other person, presumably with some sort of voice synthesizer, and on the other end of the line, they could hear it through their earbuds and do likewise. Now, you know, I think there are technological solutions to this. I don't know that that's the technological solution to this, but you know, you think back, where were we 15 years ago and what are we doing now? Or where were we 25 years ago and what are we doing now? It seems like, you know, a science fiction movie. Everybody, you know, everybody in here, almost everybody in here has checked their email. I know there's dozens of laptops or iPads or iPhones or other phones deployed at a conference. And I mean, that's just a very different type of behavior. Now, fortunately, they're not all talking, they're just checking their email. Looking at you. but that's fine. He can multitask. I don't have a problem with that, right? But as long as he's quiet. So there's a lot of things going on that 10 or 15 years from now, the questions that are problematic are going to be very different than the ones that we think are problems today.
Thank you. Well, we're going to take a short break on that to get ready for the next panel, which is going to start in 15 minutes.
Let me check my bag.
So, one more round of applause.
And that's a high. You're definitely. Thank you. I'll send you the email.